Hello, I hope you can hear me well. I want to start by thanking you a lot for your invitation, of course. I would have been so happy to be with you in Budapest today, but I had the chance to come a few months before, and I am still happy to meet you even in this tense. I want to thank Minister of Justice Judith Varga and Commissioner Dubravka Switza for their strong speeches, and to use this occasion to give a friendly salute to my colleagues of the European Parliament, Antonio Tajani, Josep Sayer, Sven Simon, and of course my friend Laszlo Trusiani, who invited me for this meeting. The question that is being asked is, what did COVID crisis taught us about Europe? And first of all, I think we have to face the reality of this experience. This COVID crisis learned that Europe is weak when such a crisis is coming. We had to go to China to try to find the solutions to protect our citizens, our member states, as just been said, were often divided on the solutions to offer to the situation. And we even saw moments when solidarity was so absent that some countries were nearly taking the sanitary emergency tools that were sent to another member state. This is the reason why we have to think about strengthening European Union in the future. We have to be conscious of what has been experienced by citizens during this crisis in order to build a Europe that is able to answer their anxiety about the future and about the future crisis. In fact, I don't think that this is a question of institutional reforms. In the institutions which we inherited, we could build far better strategies to prepare not only for future health crises, because I'm sure that we will all focus on this question of health, but for future crises as a whole. In fact, the European Union was built in a spirit of the end of history that was expected to occur. The idea that there were no crises more to happen and to expect, and that we should only focus on building this spirit of union that should get us stronger in a broader world. In fact, we see that crises occur. This is the question of this health crisis. Tomorrow it could be a migration crisis again. It could be a food food supply crisis. So the question is, how do we build a Europe that is able to face this kind of crisis? And in fact, Europe will regain its meaning for the citizens when Europe will mean the possibility to decide and choose, possibility to act together, possibility to regain our sovereignty by this union that we should continue to build in a global world. The reason why Europe is weakened is because we didn't have this kind of strategies. And the reason why the spirit of solidarity was so much lacking during the midst of the crisis was because, in fact, we didn't have the concrete means to protect our own people. So how could we share it with other member states? In fact, my view is that we thought less about strategies and too much about rules and norms. And we should focus now on concrete strategies, especially when it comes to building again European strategic autonomy. Of course, we live in a global world, and Europe has to be a global player on all fields, even in, of course, economy, industry, and trade. But we will be stronger on these different fields if we have this strategy of autonomy for European Union on very precise domains on which our sovereignty relies. If we try to identify what we will need to face the future crisis that will occur and try to build in common this autonomy, then we will be stronger also in the global dialogue about, for example, green transition, digital transition, new technologies, and all the new rules that we have to set on a global world, on a global level, to try to protect our European model. This is the first point I wanted to make, and I don't think it's, first of all, an institutional debate that we should have in the conferences on the future of Europe. It's a question about the future of Europe as a whole, and not only about the future of European Union as different institutions. People feel that Europe does not help to protect them, and people feel that Europe does not give them the power to act and the power to choose. And this is also because, and this would be my second point, people feel, as Dubravka Suica said before, people feel left aside. And this is also creating a huge democratic anxiety, a huge democratic difficulty. People feel, I would say, not only left aside, but even in a way despised by institutions that they don't understand well enough and that do not give them the possibility to choose and to decide. On this field, I see today a big democratic issue. We should build a European Union that empowers people and not that gives them the feelings that power is taken aside from them. This is, of course, a question of, on the very idea of democracy, which is in the very definition of Europe as a civilization. Because Europe is not only an organization, it's not only an international alliance of states, it's a civilization that we share in common. And Mrs. Varga had very strong words on this cultural definition of Europe. In the definition of Europe, there is the idea and the spirit of democracy, the spirit of rule of law, of course, but rule of law means exactly the possibility for people to decide inside institutions, not the fact that power is taken away from their decision. On this field, I see a huge risk of division today, a huge and dangerous risk of division between Western Europe and Eastern and Central Europe. And I think that we should revive the spirit of dialogue between our countries to try to understand the basis of this democratic disease that is intervening today in Europe. The fact that people have the feeling that Europe is built against their sovereignty. What is this democratic scheme in Europe? Europe is not an empire. Europe is not one single huge state. And it is built of member states that are the space for the debates in which democracy can take place. Europe is not made of only one single demos. It is made of a diversity of people. And this is the spirit of unity that should guide us. Unity in diversity. If we tend to forget it, then we tend to erase democracy. Europe should not take itself for a super state against member state sovereignty. Because if we do so, then people will feel that they do not have any power anymore. And this risk of misunderstanding between Western and Central and Eastern Europe is built, I guess, on this kind of problem. We cannot build a Europe that tries to erase member states' sovereignty when it comes about vital issues for some of our member states. For example, on migration, on social law, on familial issues, on family issues, and Dubravka Suica talked a lot about this question of demography, which is so important. Europe should not, European Union should not think that it is the role of the Union to decide for member states. And this is also what means rule of law. We should not condemn some member states for what they decide on their competency, because this is a clear break of rule of law, and this is today undermining the very spirit of European unity. If we build a Europe that is a European Union that is built against member state sovereignty, we will continue to feed this crisis in the spirit of democracy. I just want to end by saying that this moment of crisis is a moment of promise, because I think that we need more than ever, as it has been said before, we need more than ever a European Union that is able to strengthen our democracies in this global world made of dangers, threats, and opportunities. We need it more than ever, and this moment of crisis is a moment to take into account the lessons that we have to learn so as to build a European Union that is able to protect us in this global world, to make us stronger in the global conversation, in the globalization. And this is possible, of course, if we make, for example, of our common market, if we make it a political tool to talk to the main powers of this world and to build a Europe that is able to empower citizens by giving our member states the possibility to decide and to choose our destiny. We need to do it now, and we need to give to citizens this revived promise so that Europe can get its meaning back in the spirit of people. And I think that this dialogue you opened today is so important because we need to talk about it. The Conference of the Future of Europe will also be the occasion to continue this conversation. But having this informal, in a way, having this free conversation is so much, even in this sense, the first occasion to revive the spirit of democracy in Europe. Thank you so much for your invitation, and have a good day.